They were on their way up to Jerusalem with Jesus leading the way, and the disciples were astonished. So they've been amazed, they've been more amazed, and now they're astonished. Who's up to be astonished by Jesus this morning? Who wants to engage with him this morning and be astonished by him? While those who followed, implying a little bit of a distance, were afraid. Jesus is amazing. Let's be amazed again more deeply this morning and then be astonished. May we know him more, and we'll focus on this later. May we know him more when we leave this morning than when we came in. May some of us see more of him, and may some of us experience more of him. Jesus, we welcome your presence. Let's stand together, shall we? Jesus, we welcome your presence. We just humble ourselves in our heart for a moment. Those of us that have known you for a long time, we say, we're ready to be amazed by you again this morning, Jesus. For those of us whose hearts have grown maybe just a little cold and a little distance, we say, we make it a prayer, Jesus, amaze us again this morning with your presence and your goodness and love. Those of us that are confused this morning, may we be amazed by the brightness of your light in our lives that will bring clarity and direction. We worship you, Jesus. This is all about you, Jesus. Amen.
Let me through the fire. So my life you have been faithful. No, my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
One more time.
Singing, I worship you.
I worship. Let's declare it.
I worship you.
It's a choice.
You are here, moving in arms into this place, Lord. I worship you. You are here. You're working in this place right now. I worship you.
Sing out together. You are waymaker.
Cause you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
We're here touching every heart.
Take all those steps towards. We're just going to take one final step towards you.
going to invite you into our lives, Lord, because you are here. The things you're doing, we don't know what you're doing. These incredible things that are just too much for us to understand. So we trust you, Lord, because you are the one. You are the creator. You are the way maker. Lord, we just declare it. We speak it out to any enemy that you are the one we're going to follow. We declare it. Personal thing, worship, coming into his presence.
That is who you are.
When we do it together, he is here, we feel his presence. It physically changes the room, the atmosphere. Just got to tune into it. That's what worship is. Just putting all our focus on God. And everything else drop away.
Jesus, we thank you. You are the bread of life who sustains us. You are the light of the world who gives us direction and points us in the right way. You are the gate, the entranceway to the Father for each and every one of us. You are the good shepherd watching over, protecting, caring for. Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. God, we come to you, Jesus, we come to you this morning, saying there's no other way we want to follow. There's no other life we want to live. There's no other truth we believe in, that you, Jesus, are the one our lives are focused on. You are the true vine. are the true vine. Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please take your seats. Kids are going to just stay with us for a little bit longer. We've got various things to share, lots of things going on in our network of churches, and we just want to highlight some of them, and we think you'd be pleased to know about them, and they might excite you. We're going to start with Terry and Anne. Will you come and join me for a moment, Terry and Anne? They don't know they're coming to join me, but they're coming to join me for a moment. So Terry and Anne have been visiting. Are you all right up here? Yeah, the picture is from a couple of years ago, that's true. Come and...
Oh, there you go. It's a bit longer to speak to.
So Terry and Anne have been visiting the King's Village in Ghana, and have been they've over 15 years, 25 times over 15 years, and have recently come back from what is planned to be your final trip. Just wanted to make a comment on that, Anne.
Just quickly, not the whole trip, just
quickly. Yeah, I think Terry's not had great health, and you know it's quite an arduous journey for those that have been and know anything about it, and. I think we feel that it's time to draw a line under, to finish well, I think that's the thing, whatever we do to finish well. And we normally go for about 6 weeks, and it, you know, it's just begun to get a bit more of a challenge, so, yeah.
So you get it, 25 times over 15 years. Okay, 132 weeks they've spent in Ghana. And in particular, the picture that's shown there is they've been involved in all of the King's Village, but the Nutrition Centre, which helps malnourished children. I think the latest figures I saw, something like 10,000 babies have been saved from the Nutrition Centre that was built and pioneered by these guys. They will be championing the King's Village. They'll be going on about it. They'll be encouraging everybody to go, Terry, who wanted to go, wouldn't you? It's been a part of your life. Do you want to just say something yourself, Terry?
Yeah, if you can get to Ghana, go. It's a fantastic place, and the King's Village is just almost indescribable, the things that go on there. It's a life-changing experience, so if you haven't been to Ghana and the King's Village, put it in your diary, make sure you go, all right?
So, Sarah, we've got just a little gift. It's only a token, but we wanted as a network to honour the amazing investment this couple have made there. They've sown their lives, their finances, their, you know, everything, their futures into it. And so we wanted to honour them. So will you stand with me as we just give them a gift? So thank you.
Thank you so much. That is amazing. And I'm quite overwhelmed.
Thank you so much. So... watch your step. And also, you'll see on the screen, next slide, Ben and Marion come next weekend, who are the founders and directors of the King's Village. They're back with us. Take your seat, sorry, yes. And they're with us from next week for a few months. I'll be visiting some of the churches. But we've got an information evening next Sunday evening to hear all about the King's Village. Sign up on the NG website if you want to come along and find out more. And also we'll be giving details about our trip that will be going in October if you want to come and join us in visiting the King's Village. We're going to have an absolute blast when we go later this year as well. Okay, next slide for me. One of the things that we want to do is... growing leaders, whether you're leading worship, leading a small group, aspiring to be in leadership in your church, as a group of church leaders, we honour you, we celebrate you, and two or three times a year we put on these evenings where we give you some food, we'll feed you naturally and spiritually, and so the next one of those is coming up on Monday the 28th. Sign up again, we'd love you to be part of that if you're not involved in another group that evening at your church, but come along and be part of that evening as well. Next one. Where have we got to next? Ukraine. Again, a number of people have been saying, how can I help? What can I do? I'd like to host a family, which is truly wonderful. And there's lots of great charities working. I just wanted to point you really quickly to the Sanctuary Foundation. If you can sign up there to host a Ukrainian family. They will keep you updated on how to do that properly and all the different links. But basically, there's three things you can do at this point. You make a pledge to sponsor a Ukrainian family if you want to do that. Register your interest on the government website. You have to do that as well. So Sanctuary website, government website. And then any Ukrainian refugees also have to register, and this Sanctuary Foundation will link people up. We're going to pray for Ukraine later, but just in case you were wondering, how can I help? That's a really practical way. If you want to host a family or give money through another charity that's reputable, we would strongly recommend that you do that as well. Okay, and then Paul Traynor. Where's Paul? Is Paul around? Paul, come on. Come on. Paul and Minnie, come and join me, run a great charity, and they're feeding the homeless in Nottingham. They're part of the Haven Church. So I've got two questions for you, Paul. Only yep. Two. The first one is going to be, why do you do it? And the second one is going to be, where do you do it? Okay?
Okay, so we want to meet the needs of people, and that would be their physical needs, clothing, food, help and advice with benefits and getting people into housing. But we also want to meet their spiritual needs. So the payday is just to build relationships with them and lead them to the Lord. And we, for the last 9 years, we every Monday evening at All Souls Church and Community Centre in Radford, we feed up to 60 people a hot nutritional free course meal, really nice grub. We provide clothing, footwear, sleeping bags, toiletries, etc., help with stuff like benefits and job applications. Wednesday evenings, we do a takeaway service in Market Square in Nottingham City Centre. And, you know, once again, it's about meeting their physical needs and building relationships with them and making them feel loved. But the payday is to lead them to Christ. We have some great links with some housing associations in and around Nottingham. So this year alone, we've got 6 people off the streets and into accommodation. And yeah, we would hope to get 10 to 20 people off the street every year at least. That's it.
Amazing, isn't it? Absolutely amazing. So there's 2 things you can do to help if you'd like to. If you've got a heart to work with a homeless, want to volunteer, let me direct you to Paul's charity, Streets for Christ, and say, actually, I think I could help on one of those evenings or help cook in the day or something. So find Paul and he will direct you to how you can help with that. But we'd like our offering today to go to everything that Paul and Minnie are on with Streets for Christ. We'd like to make a really generous offering to them. So the QR code is on the screen if you want to give on your phone for a moment. And then we'll also put it on the NG website, so if you want to do that later. But we'll also, in the next, we're going to release the children in a moment. But just before we release the children, if we want to pass the offering round now, we'll do that. If you've got cash, either you can give online. All the money's going to go through the Haven Church onto the Streets for Christ charity. If you give online, obviously you can gift aid that really easily. There's a thing to tick there and be part of that. After the bucket has passed you by, then if you want to take your children to the children's work or young people, let me just explain where everything is. You will need to take a registration form with you. So you'll have to fill in the details for your children. There's some at the different points and some by the door there if you've not filled them in yet, but you will need to do that. So through the corridor here and down the corridor, we've got the F2s through to years 5 or 6. If you're in year 6, you've got a choice, but 5 or 6 that way. So that's primary school age, head that way. Noughts to F1s, preschool. You're through in the creche area, which is directly behind there. And then if you're one of our young people here, so if you're in secondary school, then through over in the reception room, which is that way there. But you'll all need to fill in a form. So if kids, if you want to head there, that's great. We're just going to let the music play for a moment. Feel free to keep giving online just for a moment if you're not quite finished that. Thank you. Lord, we thank you for the faithfulness of Terry and Anne and all they've sown into Ghana and the King's Village. May you repay them many times over, both in this age and the age to come. May you bless them beyond all expectation as they have so faithfully served you. And for Paul and many, and for this offering, for the generosity of this offering, Lord, we pray it'll be multiplied. It will change many people's lives. We commit it to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. For Paul and Minnie, may you strengthen them, encourage them, cause them to have an incredibly fruitful ministry in seeing lives rescued and transformed. Many stories of Jesus to follow from the work that they do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'm absolutely thrilled that Kate Kent, leader of The Rock, they're having a great time at The Rock this morning. This season, real explosion of people joining the church and growth. And so really honoured that you guys are part of our network. But thrilled, Kate's obviously a friend and part of the leadership. And so really open your hearts to say, God, what are you saying to me this morning? So Kate, we welcome you.
Thank you. I need to hire this, bear with. Oh, we need one of these at church. Can you see me over the top? Hang on. Fantastic. Thank you for the intro, John. Lovely to be here with all of you this morning, NG Tribe, brothers and sisters in Christ, just so exciting. And when John asked me to preach, the first thing I always do when someone asks me to preach is say, Lord, am I meant to be preaching? But I thought, this is a bit of a no-brainer because this is my family. And then the second thing I'll say is, Lord, what do you want me to say? And sometimes you can wait months for an answer for something like that. But fortunately, the Lord was really good to me. And he said to me straight away, tell my people, well done. And I said, do you want to add anything to the well done? Because, you know, that's not going to take me long to preach. And he said, tell my people, well done. Well done, good and faithful servants. Well done for the last 2 years of getting through COVID. Well done for overcoming. Well done for not giving up. Well done, you leaders, for leading your churches strongly. Well done for how you've navigated church during lockdown. Well done for persevering. Well done for continuing to use your talents and not bury them. Well done for still giving. Well done for encouraging others. And well done for not giving up on me. Well done, church. John, well done for leading our network so brilliantly in that season. John and David, thank you. Well done for looking after us so well in that season. Terry and Anne, well done. Good and faithful servants. Paul and Minnie, wow, well done. Amazing charity. We've had people, Tina and Gary came and helped us as a church to do things to upgrade our building during COVID. And God says, well done. We have people in our network that are fostering and adopting, and they've done it all the way through lockdown. Steve and Helen, well done. Forgive me if I'm leaving names out. All you parents who became teachers in lockdown, well done. Oh, thank you, Jesus, that mine were at uni. To those of you who looked after the elderly and the vulnerable in lockdown, well done. And all our NHS staff, anybody here working for them, Claire Coops, well done. Well done. This isn't me, guys. This is God. You understand? This is God saying, well done. Hearing those words, well done, good and faithful servant, it should be the heart's desire of every Christian. It's the kind of thing you expect to hear, well, you wouldn't because you'd be dead, but it happens at funerals, doesn't it? But I don't want to wait till I'm dead to hear God say those words to me. And we all need encouragement. Granted, some need it more than others. But it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you do. We all need encouragement. It's universal. We were designed to be loved and accepted and given words of affirmation. And we probably all know loads of people here who are downtrodden and depressed and distressed. And those kind of people need to hear words of affirmation from people. They need to hear the well done from God. Wow, well done, good and faithful servant. Now, I'm an encourager through and through. It's a gift. It's not difficult for me. It comes very easily to me. But just because I'm good at giving encouragement doesn't mean that I don't need it back. I do. And actually, if you've heard of the five love languages, one of them is words of affirmation, and that is my top thing. And you might have noticed that John just pressed down on my shoulders and said something to me just before I got up. That does something to me. That's my daddy saying, well done, you've got this, you can do this. That's affirmation. It does us good. Because I can't lie to you. I don't know about you, but I have found the last 2 years really hard. Like, really hard. I've hated it. Hated it with a passion. And for those of you who can remember, it was actually this time, 2 years ago, we had this service, and we kind of knew something was happening, but they let us carry on. And literally, I think it was within days, we were in complete lockdown. And as leaders, we had to work hard at working out, oh, what do our churches look like? How does it operate during lockdown? What do we do? You know, how do we look after people pastorally when we can't even see them? You know, and I'm not tech savvy at all. So, you know, we're on these Zoom calls. We called our meetings Cobra meetings. We just wanted to keep it in line with Boris. And we'd be on our Cobra meetings and they'd be talking about what we're going to do with Zoom. And it's just like, and I just thought, Lord, what am I doing here? I can't do this. I'm not enjoying this. And then, as you remember, there were points within lockdown where we were allowed back. I think the first time we were allowed back in the building, it was just a skeleton staff, so we were just preaching into a camera like that. There was about six people in the room. That's soul-destroying. Oh, man, that's so boring. You have all this wonderful band behind you. It was just so hard. And then the time that we were actually all allowed back in the building, it was socially distanced. We were in masks. We were told that we couldn't even sing. I said, that's not church. That's not a good experience of church. It was horrible. And I'm not going to lie, I had some major pity parties during those 2 years. Major. I mean, thankfully, I think most of them were just in front of God. I think I tried to hold it back from a lot of people. But, you know, I'd say to God, what's going to happen here? Am I going to have a job at the end of this? Are people going to come back? Are people still going to give? Are we still going to be able to bless the charities that we look after? Are they going to suffer? It was horrible. And I remember a few weeks into lockdown, and you guys will probably all remember this, and the weather was amazing. Like, the sun was out, and I know it was March, but it wasn't even just the sun. The heat was out. I mean, it was beautiful, wasn't it? Just amazing. And in our cul-de-sac, we've got a few elderly people, and we've got quite a few people who were furloughed. And our office faces out into the cul-de-sac, so we can see everything that's going on. And every day around 11 o'clock, we'd just be beavering away on our computers, trying to make church work, trying to keep people happy. And outside our window, there'd be people drinking gin, striking up barbecues. Man, I was so jealous. They were having a great time. And in the end, I think we took like 2 weeks holiday out of six that year. And we were meant to be on our sabbatical. And that all went out the window as well. It was awful. I hated it. And if that wasn't bad enough, there was absolutely nothing to do. Nothing. Like, you couldn't go to the cinema. You couldn't go and get a bit of coffee and cake. You couldn't see your mates. No football. Absolutely nothing. The only thing you're allowed to do was go on a one-hour Boris walk. Well, I hate walking, so my pity party just got bigger and bigger all the time. But, well done, good and faithful servants. You know, this little verse is found in the parable of the talents in Matthew 25, sometimes called the parable of the money bags, or the miners, or the bags of gold. But the meaning behind the parable extends way beyond anything to do with financial investment. It's about the fact that we were put on this planet on purpose, for a purpose, born with a purpose, to do something with the gifts that God has given us and to give him all the glory. I want to read to you from the Street Bible. It's not even really a Bible. I don't even think you can call it a paraphrase, to be fair. But the story in here of the money bags is absolutely brilliant. So I'm going to read to you from this. Imagine a man, loaded, goes off on a long business trip. He sends a memo around to three of his staff, calling them into his office. They arrive and he tells them, I've sold my stake in the business and I need you guys to look after the dosh while I'm away. He pulls out three briefcases and starts handing them out. The first guy, who's a real talent, gets a case stuffed with 500 grand's worth of crisp notes. The second guy, good, but nothing stunning, he gets 200 grand. And the last guy, steady, gets just 100 grand. And then the boss says, that's it, I'm off. and he leaves them staring at each other in shock. The first guy goes off to read up on his investment mags. He picks the brains of financial advisors and eventually comes up with a detailed investment portfolio. After a while, he's doubled the money and he's hit the million mark. He's well happy. The second guy also goes off and puts together a strategy and likewise doubles his money to 400 grand. The third guy, however, bottles it and he thinks, what if the market crashes? What if there's a run on the banks? What if I buy gold and then they discover an enormous gold mine lying 2 feet under every garden in the city and the gold price plummets? So he buys a safe, stuffs the money inside and buries it in his back garden. Ages later, the boss comes back and rings round the three. I'm back. Let's meet. Usual place. The first sits there looking smug and says, you gave me 500 grand and I've done a bit of wheeling and dealing, a bit of ducking and diving, dodging and weaving, all legal, of course, and I've doubled your money. He hands over two briefcases stuffed full with a cool million. And his boss says, well done. You've done well. You've proved yourself. And now you get to manage bigger projects for me. You and me, we've got some good times lined up together. The second guy is also looking pretty pleased with himself. And he says, you gave me 200 grand and I've doubled your money as well. Handing the boss the case, he says, there's 400 grand in there. And likewise, his boss is impressed. Well done. You've done well. I've got some good projects for you too. And you're going to have nothing to worry about from now on. The third guy is twitching by now, and the boss turns to him and says, and you only gave me 100 grand, he mumbles. And what did you do with it? Frowns his boss. Well, I heard the rumors about your middle name being Ruthless and how you can't be doing with losers, and I didn't want to risk losing the cash, so I buried it in a safe place. In a safe. It's all here. There's not a fiver missing, the whole caboodle. The boss is fuming. You ready for this, guys? You lily-livered, useless, gutless, spineless excuse for a half-life. You're pathetic. If you knew I was so ruthless, why didn't you get your act together and at least put the money into an interest account? Is that really so hard? What's the inflation rate? How much have I lost? Unless you're too lazy to get off your backside and do the sums. And then he takes the briefcase and gives it to the first guy saying, you can have it. Because those who have got loads will get given even more. And those who've got zilch, even what they've got will get given to those with loads. That's how it works. And get this loser out of my sight. Throw him out on the streets where he belongs. And if he gets piles from the pavement, tough. Wow. I told you it's probably not even a paraphrase, but anyway, it's a good story, isn't it? So hard hitting. You see, it's not good enough to know you have something in your hands that God has given you. You can't just do nothing with what you've got. You can't just stick it on a shelf and hope for the best. The gifts that we receive are things like our skills, our abilities, our talents, our experiences, our social connections, our families, our education, and our experiences. And the point of this parable is that we've been blessed with those by God, and we're meant to put them to good use. But I'm here to encourage us this morning. So you don't need to worry about the lazy, lily-livered guy, okay? We're not going to talk about him at all. It's verse 21 that we're going to stay camped in. And it reads this. The master was full of praise. The master is Jesus. So let's replace this little verse with the word Jesus. Jesus is full of praise. Jesus says to us, well done, good and faithful servants. You've been faithful in handling this small amount. So now I'm going to give you many more responsibilities. We're going to celebrate together. So for what's left of this morning, I just want to break down that one little verse. Firstly, well done, good and faithful servant. You know, the term well done, it means endearment. It's a term of endearment. It's a compliment. It's one of the most powerful ways to let someone know that they're valued and that they're appreciated. And doesn't it always mean so much when it comes from someone that you look up to? Just like I said earlier about John. Anytime me and Ali go and see John for a mentoring, in the early days, we used to get battered quite a lot because we were just always not doing stuff right. But as we've grown and listened to his wonderful advice and gained more knowledge and wisdom, we don't get told off as much. So when we go there now, it's wonderful because often we'll come away and it's like, yay, Daddy's pleased with us. That's how it feels, doesn't it? When someone's proud of you, it feels so good. But this well done, it was way more than a compliment. It was actually a commendation of their character. Jesus was saying, wow, what you've done there, you've reflected me. you've reflected me and God and our motives by the way that you've handled what I've entrusted to you. You see, the two servants who made the money, they were devoted and submitted to their master. They wanted to serve him wholeheartedly. And that's what we should want to do for Jesus. They earned the commendation because they took his trust seriously. When he was handing out those money bags, they could see what a blessing and a privilege it was. I mean, I don't know about you, but I've never been handed a money bag. That'd be nice, wouldn't it? But then, of course, you have got the pressure of thinking, now what? What do I do? What am I going to do with what I've been given? What am I going to do with what God's put in my hand? But they wanted to please their master because their master was saying that he was pleased with them. Otherwise, he wouldn't have given them the money and entrusted them in the first place. And God loves faithfulness, steadiness, loyalty, consistency, hard work, dependability, trustworthiness, and devotion. And he's asking us, be faithful with what I'm giving you. And we don't have time today to go into all the faithful characters in the Bible. You know, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Esther. So many faithful characters. But faithfulness is actually one of the greatest requirements of the Christian faith. But according to American Bible teacher John Bevere, there's another word for faithfulness. And it's the word multiplication. I'm going to define multiplication for you by posing a scenario. So I'm going to give you two choices, okay? So would you rather have £10,000 a day for 31 days? Do the math, 310,000. Or would you rather have one penny a day that doubles every day for 31 days? Now, at a first glance, you think, 10 grand a day, fantastic. 1p a day, so on day two you get two, and on day four you get four, and on day three you get eight. But the thing with the multiplying penny is that it is multiplying. The other one is just an addition. And multiplication is actually incredible, because what happens with the penny is, how long does it take? It takes 21 days to get to the 10 grand. So you could have had that 10 grand every day for 21 days. If you take the second option, you only get it at day 21. But by day 28, that penny has multiplied to 1.3 million. And by day 31, that penny is now at over 10 million pounds. That, my friends, is the power of multiplication. And we serve a God who loves to multiply our efforts. I want to give you a real-life example of multiplication at work. Little girl, Hattie Wyatt, six-year-old girl, lived near a Baptist church in Philadelphia. The Sunday school was crowded, and the minister told her that one day they were going to have buildings big enough to house absolutely everyone. 2 years later, at age eight, Hattie died. And after a funeral, Hattie's mother gave the minister a little bag that they found underneath the daughter's pillow. It had 57 cents in it that she saved up. And there was a note in her handwriting that said, "This is to help build the church bigger so that children can go to Sunday school." The minister changed all the money into pennies and offered each penny for sale to his congregation. He received $250, and 54 of the 57 cents were given back. The $250 itself was also changed into pennies and sold by the newly formed Hattie Mae Society. And in this way, the 57 cents kept multiplying. 26 years later, in a talk entitled "The History of the 57 Cents," the minister explained the result of her donation. The church membership was now over 5,600 people. They were able to set up a hospital where tens of thousands of people had been treated. The society had put 80,000 young people through university, and 2,000 people were sent out to preach the gospel. And all this happened because little Hattie invested 57 cents. Isn't that incredible? I mean, Hattie, she never got to see her success. But guys, we're not called to success. We're called to faithfulness. And when we just obey God, he will bless our efforts more than we could ever imagine. The next part of this verse says, "You've been faithful with a few things." So God wants us to be faithful. But more importantly, he wants us to be faithful in the little. And we often don't like that, do we? We don't like starting at the bottom and working our way up. We don't like the small things. But obviously the Bible says, do not despise the day of small beginnings. It must be there for a reason. I wonder, how faithful are we in our little money, in our little power and our little responsibilities or whatever little God has put in our hands. Because I've got a bit of a spoiler alert for you. That little is a test. It's a test. And your faithfulness towards that little thing in your hands is going to determine whether you are qualified for much or for more or for bigger. Our success in handling little things today determines our futures. So let's be faithful with whatever we've got in our hand right now. There's a story about a huge bank where one of the employees was up for a really significant promotion. And one day, this guy was in the cafe and the president was behind him in the line. And he picked two butter sachets up and hid them under his bread so he didn't have to pay for them. And because of that one little incident, the bank manager knew, I can never employ this guy to look after my money if he's stealing two little pats of butter. A guy called Daniel Webster was beginning his career as a lawyer. He took a small case for a tiny fee of just £20. And the case turned out to be really difficult. He spent a lot of time on it. There was a lot of preparation. And he had to make a trip on this during the process of all this. And it cost him more than the fee that he was going to win. But he was determined to do a good job. He was determined to win the case. And he did. Years later, a large company approached him at short notice, asking for his help on a case that they were willing to pay a huge sum of money for. He took the case, and what he found was the case was exactly the same as the one that he'd done 20 years before. He found it easy, it wasn't difficult, and he went on to win. But if he hadn't have been willing to be bothered and committed in the small stuff, he'd have never got to that stage in his career. See, the world has little all wrong. The world screams out that big is best. But you never really get to be big unless you've gone through the little, not if you want it to last anyway. So as a network of churches and as individuals, let's manage what we've got well. Let's agree to be content with where we're at, but keep pressing forward and taking strides to do the best that we can with what we've got in our hands. You know, our vision for NG is to have a church in every postcode. How many of you know how many postcodes there are in Nottingham? How many? Thank you, David. 16 in the city and 32 in the county. I'm glad you said that because I thought it was 29. So got my stats wrong. That's a lot, isn't it? And we're expecting a church in every single one of those postcodes to be a part of this network. That's the vision. I remember Joyce Meyer talking about her preaching and just when she was starting out, she was struggling. People didn't really want her to speak. She was female. And she was preaching to 50 people. And the Lord said to her, Joyce, if you only get to preach to 50 people for the rest of your life, will you still follow me? And she said, yes. She started off in the little, and look at her now, preaching to millions all over the world. See, great things come from small beginnings, so let's just stay committed and stay faithful. Let's keep sowing our seeds. As a network, we'll keep giving generously to the King's Village. We'll keep meeting twice a year like this. You know what? God absolutely loves this. He loves the unity of his church. We'll keep looking after and investing in our leaders. We'll keep looking at different ways that we can impact and influence this city. And we're going to keep doing whatever else God asks us to do. And we're going to stay faithful in the little because God will add to us if we do that. I remember when we started in the network, there were 5 churches. We're on 8 now. It's happening. Doesn't always happen in our timing, but it's happening. Thirdly, this little verse says, I will put you in charge of many things. Some of you might be thinking, I don't want anything else. I've got enough on my plate. Don't give me anything else. But actually, this little charge, it's a reward. You get rewards when you do what God asks you to do. They're part of our faith. Hebrews 11:6 says this, anyone who comes to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. God's saying, if you do this right, if you're faithful, if I can trust you in the small stuff, I am going to bless you with greater responsibility, with greater privilege, with greater power and authority and influence. Anyone want a bit of that? Seeing more people come to Christ? God's reward isn't retirement to a rest home. It's a challenge for further growth And there is so much more for us. There's so much more for us as a network. There is so much more for every single one of us in this building this morning. Our future is so bright. So I just want to encourage you to keep pressing in, because hard work always pays off. Even when no one else can see it, even when you think that you're being overlooked by your boss, hard work always pays off, because he never misses a thing. As a network, during COVID, we've seen growth in our congregations. We've acquired buildings, we've faced opposition, and we've overcome. We've been rewarded because of our faithfulness. And when we use our gifts and our talents for God, he multiplies their effectiveness, and he blesses us with more and more and more. I'm sure you've seen it all played out in your own lives. You know, 12 years ago when we started the Rock Church, I wasn't even an ordained minister. We were just two people just wanting to serve God and see a load of people come to Christ. And when I look at what God's done in my life, when I've stayed faithful in the small, when I've stayed faithful when I've not been paid, God's just added and added and added to us. Responsibility, influence. I don't want to go into it because I don't want to boast, because I can't boast, because it's nothing of me. It's nothing to do with us. It's just the fact that we were faithful. And this is what God does for people when they're faithful. You know what? It's not just about being a good Christian. It's not about how many times you rock up at church. It's not even actually about how much we love other people. It's about what we did with what God put in our hands. And finally, this little verse tells us, come and share your master's happiness. You know, that word happiness in Greek, it's chara. It means joy. Come and share in Jesus' joy. Wow. Can you see what Jesus has done in the parable? He's inviting them in to share. He's not treating them as servants or employees. He's saying, you're part of the family. You're a son. You're a daughter. You are so welcome. Come and share. Come and walk alongside me in my kingdom. Come and experience all the goodness and favor and gifts that come from being a part of me. You know, this joy, this happiness that we get, it's going to be far better than Forest beating Liverpool tonight. You're clapping my faith, aren't you, Paul? Yeah. It's going to be far better than the best cake I've ever eaten, and I love my cake. It's going to be better than the best promotion you've ever had. This joy is going to be unexplainable, undescribable. It's going to be absolutely stunning. So I said that I wanted to encourage us because that was what God told me to do. But I want to leave us with a little challenge as well. And it's this. Let's be faithful in the small stuff. Let's be humble in the bigger stuff. And I want you to believe that there is a reward waiting for you from God. Because some people have got a wrong mindset around the way that God wants to bless. My Bible tells me that he longs to give good gifts to his children. So in your faithfulness, I want you to be expectant for a reward. Let's not let well done on our tombstones mean that we were cremated. Let's use our talents to the glory of God and to further his kingdom. Thank you, John. Do you want me to say that one again? Let's not let well done on our tombstones mean that we were cremated. Oh, I'm lost on you. Oh, you got it now. You get it. Hey. Let's use our talents to the glory of God to further his kingdom. Well done, NG. Well done, good and faithful servants. My encouragement is that the Lord is pleased with us. Amen. I think we need to take our feet.
Dave, will you stand up a moment? Dave Horner, just stand up just a sec, just where you are. Just give a quick wave and then you can sit back down again. That's it. Dave doesn't know me very well. I don't know him. I was having coffee with Rob at the Hope Cafe a couple of weeks ago, and somebody had just dripped some coffee, I think, through the... And Dave has just started looking after all the charity shops that Hope Church, just started working there. But somebody... Dave doesn't work in the cafe, but had dropped some drips of coffee, and I just noticed Dave quietly. He doesn't know I was watching. Just wipe up the coffee that had been spilt. Just wipe it up. And I thought to myself, I said to Rob at the time, he'll do great managing those shops. He'll do great managing those shops. Doesn't mean every day will be easy, but it means that success, the blessing of God, will come your way, because clearly you know something of what Kate has been talking about. Let me pray, and then we're going to continue to worship. Jesus, we thank you. Thank you that you smile upon us. Thank you that your favor is on our lives. Thank you for many of us in this room. You have convinced us of the truth that Kate has been talked about. Has talked about that as we have been faithful in the little, you have blown our minds and trusted us with so much more. And we're so deeply grateful. So Lord, we just receive your favor again this morning. We say thank you, thank you, thank you. And we make that declaration again in our hearts. We're serving you all of our days. With whatever you have given us, both natural, spiritual, financial blessings, Lord, we give them back to you. And will you multiply them in our lives? Jesus, we trust you with our lives. Let's stand together as we continue to worship.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Sing that out again. In the darkness we were waiting.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Sing it out together, praise the Father.
Till that stone was moved for good,
for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tomb, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father on the star, and the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit is in the flame. Now this gospel, the truth of old, shall not kneel, shall not fade. By His blood and by His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father.
Is we can now have just a little bit more relaxation about moving around and that type of thing. We'll just avoid the mass grow. You guys are safe if people keep their distance. I'm going to continue to worship, but Kate was talking about we all need encouragement. So let's start here. If you want someone, if you just feel like I'm in that place of needing some encouragement this morning, I believe Jesus would want to encourage you. He would want you to know Him more, to see Him more, to experience Him more. So if you're looking for some encouragement this morning, if you just raise your hand where you are, then I'm going to just release the leaders to go and pray for anyone with a raised hand. So just at the back there. So any of the NG leaders, partners, if you start to, if anyone else is just looking for some encouragement this morning as we're worshiping, let's start there this morning. There, third row back or so, that's great. Let's continue to worship, but let's just start there. Let's make this a prayer now as Paul leads us.
I want to know You, Lord, like I know a friend. I want to know You, Lord. I want to know You, Lord, like I know a friend. I want to know You, Lord. I want to know You, Lord. I want to know You, Lord, like I know a friend. I want to know You, Lord. I want to know You, Lord, like I know.
I know a friend. measure of what I've been told, not good enough, but you're here with me.
Let's sing that again.
Lord, I've been told to be ashamed. Lord, I've been told I don't measure up.
And you know, the actual word encouragement in the New Testament is a word that comes from the word we get Holy Spirit. It means to console, to comfort, to come alongside. So we're not after just a feeling of warmth, which is great. We're not just after a feeling of leaving better than we came in. We're after God through His Spirit to do something in our spirits. We're after an encounter with Him. So I want to encourage you throughout this place, as we just continue, we see out this service, let's not rush out of this service, but let's make sure that we receive and appropriate everything that God has for us in this moment. So let's open our hearts again, but let's open our spirits. If we get an emotion, great, but it's our spirits that God wants to minister to right now. It's a tough old world out there. We can take it on in Christ, but we need some comfort. We need some comfort from the Holy Spirit to say, yes, we can go, we can take, we can conquer, we can multiply, we can go forward, we can take this little and be faithful in it, and God turn it to much. We can do these things, but everybody has got a unique situation right now. No one is void of this. Everybody has got a unique situation where they need some comfort, where they need some consolation, where they need the Holy Spirit to speak into them and encourage them. So let that be your practice right now in these closing minutes. And maybe as the band plays us out and we just give God one more lift of praise in this place and exhortation. If you have never been filled with the Holy Spirit, if you cannot say that you 100% have been baptized in the Spirit, if you have never experienced the power of God, I'm not just talking about saving power, I'm talking about the power of God for your life so you can live life to the full, so that you can do exploits for God, so that you can move in spiritual gifts, so that you can do everything that God has called you to do, then we would just love you to come out as a step of faith, and we would love just to pray with you, lay hands on you. And God will fill you because He promises. He says, ask and you'll receive. And He gives good gifts to His children. It's really not any more complicated than that. We make it more complicated sometimes, but it's not. So as we just continue to worship, just receive the encouragement you need from God in your spirits. And if you want a full measure of that for the very first time, why don't you just come and we would just love to pray with you.
Explain what we're going to do now is Stephen is going to come and pray for us, pray for Ukraine. It's really important we do that as part of our gatherings. And then after he's done that, those of you with children, I'm going to release you to pick up your children. And then you've got a choice then. Either refreshments have been served for another half an hour or so, a bit longer maybe, but go and grab some refreshments, drinks or whatever. But I'm going to ask the band just to stay and continue to worship in here for a while, even though formally we're closing. It's such a great atmosphere just to be filled with the Spirit this morning. Such a great atmosphere just to allow your spirit be stirred. So stay and enjoy that. But I can't believe there isn't somebody who wants to come and be prayed for this morning. And so we'll do that. But Stephen, if you can come and pray for Ukraine first, that'd be great.
Thanks, John. Oh, man. Well, let's unite in prayer this morning, should we? And let's draw encouragement from what Kate's been saying to us. Well done. And before we pray for Ukraine this morning, I just want to say, just allow that well done to just go deep into your soul, to become the grounding of who you are and who we are. God says, well done, well done. Yeah. And we come to pray from that position. That's what I want to say. I mean, just chatting earlier before the service and talking about our ailments and this person talking about their ailments, and then you say, and there's a war in Ukraine. It's difficult to navigate all of that. But I do want to say to you, your pain is still your pain. Don't diminish that. Bring that to Christ. Bring that to God. He loves you. He cares for you. He meets with you in your pain. And find your place of grounding so that you can stand strong. I just want to read just a few verses of scripture, and then I'm going to lead us in prayer. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's evil schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. And in addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. We just acknowledge the Spirit of Christ here with us this morning. Before I lead us in a prayer, I just want us to raise our voices together this morning. We take our ground, we stand firm in Christ, and from that position, we offer our resistance against the works of evil in this world. And we raise up our voices in the name of Jesus. This is how we do it. Come on, folks, we're going to pray for this country. We're going to pray into this part of the world. Let's just raise our voices in the name of Jesus. Oh, hear our prayers, Father, in the name of Jesus. We turn our eyes and we focus upon this part of the world, and we pray for peace to come in the name of Jesus. We pray for wars to cease in the name of Jesus. We pray for your power and love to be released in the name of Jesus. We pray for your people, Lord, to rise up in your strength in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, for an outpouring of your grace and your mercy in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, for a cessation of war in the name of Jesus. Hear our prayer, Lord, as we, Lord, humbly come before you today. Oh, Father, hear our prayer in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And let me lead us. Heavenly Father, you who make wars cease to the ends of the earth, hear our prayers today for Ukraine and for all who caught up in conflict. I don't know whether you know, but the churches in Ukraine have been holding on to Psalm 31 and praying it. Been released as a video through the Bible Society. I'm going to take some of those words out of Psalm 31 as I lead us in prayer this morning, and also some words from a prayer from Tia Fund. We come before you numbed by the horror, disturbed by its potential to escalate, powerless in knowing how to respond. But you, Lord, are never powerless in the face of evil. You are never helpless as you walk amongst the ruins. You are never absent in the arena of war, an ever-present help you are in times of trouble. We beseech you, hear our prayers today. In joining with those in Ukraine from Psalm 31, we say, since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set before me, for you are my refuge. And with those in distress, we say, I would be glad and rejoice in your love, for you saw saw my affliction and knew the anguish of my soul. You have not given me into the hands of the enemy. Lord, hear our prayer and be merciful to me, Lord, for I am in distress. My eyes grow weak with sorrow, my soul and body with grief. My life is consumed by anguish and my years by groaning. I am forgotten as though I were dead. I have become like pottery, for I hear many whispering. Terror on every side, they conspire against me and plot to take my life. Heavenly Father, we pray for and stand with those who live with terror on every side and pray against those who conspire to take life. You who makes wars cease, hear our prayer. And Heavenly Father, hear our prayers for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. Lord, we ask for peace for those who need peace, reconciliation for those who need reconciliation, and comfort for all who don't know what tomorrow will bring. Lord, may your kingdom come and your will be done. Lord God, we ask for you to be with all, especially children who are suffering as the crisis in the Ukraine deteriorates. Lord, for those who are anxious and fearful, for those who are bereaved, injured, or have lost their lives, and for those who have lost loved ones, hear our prayers. Lord, we ask that decision makers hear your voice. Parents protecting their families, deciding whether to stay or leave. Church leaders as they support and comfort people. Lord, we ask for wise actions from global leaders who have the power not only to start wars, but also to stop them. And we pray for peace talks to grow, for diplomatic pressure to increase, for the silent majority to speak, and for a negotiated settlement in this war-torn land that will allow brothers and sisters to live peacefully as neighbors. Lord, hear our prayer. And Father God, we cry out for an end to this crisis, for mercy, peace, and truth. You are light, hope, power, and love. Love the Lord, all his faithful people. The Lord preserves those who are true to him, but the proud he pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. We pray these things in the name of the risen Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Stephen. So as we leave here, may you be empowered to know Jesus more, to see Jesus more, to experience Jesus more, and take his presence with you into your schools, your workplaces, down your road, to make a difference for him. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So those of you with children, if I can release you first to do that. If you want to be filled with the Spirit, I'm going to ask you to come down here, and we will pray for you here. I'm also interested, if you're between 18 and 30, we'd love to capture all your email addresses and put on some stuff. So if you can come down here, if you're between 18 and 30, we'd love to just capture your email addresses and do some stuff for that. So feel free, grab a refreshment, stay and worship, be filled. Don't forget your kids, whatever you do. 18s to 30s here. Thank you for being part of our service. It's been a real joy to host you.
He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
I believe. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion.